Thank you, ladies and gentlemen. The topic for the next panel discussion will be, should employment be the key focus of education? May I please invite on stage Chairperson Dr. S. Vaidhyasubramaniam, Dean Planning and Development, SASTRA University. May I request on stage our panelists, Mr. Deepak Phatak, Professor, Department of CSE, IIT, Bombay. Mr. Krishnakumar Natarajan, Managing Director and CEO, MindTree. Ms. Lalitha Balakrishnan, Principal, MOP Vaishnav College, Chennai. And Mr. Uday, Desai, Director, IIT, Hyderabad.
Very distinguished co-panelists, ladies and gentlemen, I'm extremely happy to be back again for the third edition of ThinkEDU. Amidst a number of reasons for which I'm happy, that's the first reason, and the second reason is that I'm going to chair a session on the topic through which I made my debut article, and after which I've been regularly contributing for the New Indian Express since 2010. Now, the topic is, should employment be the key focus of education? And I refer to my article, my debut article, that was the famous or the infamous NASSCOM McKinsey report of 2005, based on the experience of some 83 HR managers. They generalized that, you know, only 25% of the engineering graduates are employable. And then everybody started quoting that. And I asked the question myself, whether the NASSCOM McKinsey report has an expiry date at all. Because even today, this morning, somebody was quoting that only 25% of the engineering graduates are employable. It is unfortunate that this skilled workforce, which forms the revenue spine of the IT industry, is debranded to that extent. Let's park that thought on one hand. On the other side, could it be because that we are not mindful of the fact that there is also a critical mass of students who know that the more and more that they are getting educated, the less and less they are employable. And they have found this earlier before much damage is done to them. In fact, there is an interesting statistic to show that the unemployment rate keeps on increasing as one keeps on getting himself or herself educated. So there is this critical mass of people who said, I want to get away from the educational system and let me start on my own. So there is, on the other side, a number of people who got into entrepreneurship as a career proposition. And this is not something that is unique, it is something that is intrinsic to the country also. The Global Entrepreneurship Monitor, which publishes its annual report, starting from 1999, where only 10 countries participated, today more than 100 countries participate, and India joined this list in 2002, it found that there is an intrinsic propensity amongst Indians, and they compare India, China, and USA, within a specific age group, to find that there is an intrinsic propensity amongst a majority of Indians within this age group of 25 to 60 who have a natural liking towards entrepreneurship. But do we recognize that? Do we reward that? In fact, I would like to share an interesting experience at Coimbatore, Tirupur, close to Coimbatore, where in a rotary function, we were discussing, there was a very great scholar, an academic, PhD from one of the reputed institutions, and also an equally successful businessman who runs a unit that is engaged in exporting knitwear, revenue running to a couple of 100 crores. And nobody in the discussion asked the person with PhD and publications, you know, people introduce, he so-and-so, they know what he has studied, but nobody asked him what you have done. But then the other gentleman, a very successful businessman, so successful, But there was this gentleman who went and asked him, what have you studied? So I saw his face, it became so shrunk, he was so dwarfed. A successful entrepreneurship, he has done so much. Nobody wanted to ask him what he did, but went to ask him what he studied. And to somebody who has studied so much, nobody asked him what he did. That's point number two. Are we actually encouraging entrepreneurship? Thirdly is the issue of skills, about which a lot of people have said. In fact, Mr. Palamraju said that today the acceptability of skills as a formal educational vehicle is a little tough. But thanks to some of the initiatives that are happening at the NSDC and NSDA level, because this entire skilled workforce, in my opinion, is an open-air university. In fact, we should just go honor them and give them a degree. Here is an attempt where the educational system now is trying to actually formalize the informal talent that the skilled workforce has. And the fifth dimension is this entire issue of personality development. What should be the role of education institutions? On one hand, even families are outsourcing the responsibilities to education institutions, saying that, you know, you teach the students attitude and all that. Because I very strongly believe that what a family or a society cannot teach in the first 12 years of schooling, a college cannot do. And on the other hand, there is equal pressure from corporate saying that, you know, teach them the corporate workplace skills. So what will an educational institution do? Because there is a series of such issues that an educational institution has to handle and make sure that they don't compromise on key focal areas for which their very existence is all about. So this is the issue, a multidimensional issue that this panel, I think, will actually enlighten me as well as the audience on what should be the focal areas beyond just employment. And to share this, we have a very, very distinguished panel, and let me begin this discussion by inviting Professor Deepak Phatak.
Thank you. I would first like to observe that we talk about employment, but the term employment describes an event, and we are actually talking about making an event the main focus of a long duration, which is education. I think the education duration is actually not just, it does not complete with your degree. Education is now recognized as a lifelong education. I think it is therefore wrong to say that the focus of a fairly long duration extensive activity can just be a single milestone or event. So obviously we should mean, when we talk about employment, we mean sustainability in that employment. That means the education must be such that not only person gets employed, but does well. And to do well, the person will have to learn on the job as well, which means the education must focus on training people on how to learn. Now that is an absolutely essential component of education, which probably is missed out because the education by rote and the education by conventional examination system does not either emphasize training to learn, nor does it evaluate people or assess people on their ability to learn on their own, which is what the learning would be later after they take up a job, of course under mentorship of other colleague employees and so on. The second point which has already been made is, if everybody is educated just for an employment, then who creates that employment? So, for a sustainable employment, there has to be adequate employment opportunities available in the first place. Creation of large number of jobs for people to be employed is a big question that begs to be answered. The most plausible manner to do so is to inculcate entrepreneurial thoughts and spirits. And I'm not speaking of building only large corporations and large companies, but of creating micro enterprises in cities, towns and villages. This dire need of the society cannot be fulfilled unless the education also provides an opportunity to learn basic principles of entrepreneurship. We have been talking about teachers. My favorite axiom is that there are two professions which are actually very unique professions, teaching and soldiering. only a small percentage of any society wants to willingly join these two professions. A wise society creates an environment by which not only this small percentage is completely attracted, but a large number of fence-sitters are also attracted. An unwise society such as ours throws even the desiring few who want to become teachers to go and write COBOL programs and Java programs for IT companies by creating an environment which is not very conducive for people to join teaching. But I digress. Oops, my technology gave up. Sorry. Now, entrepreneurship is something that needs to be inculcated with some training. The skill training, the conventional education, and basic principles of entrepreneurship, I think, must be created in a composite fashion to form the backbone of the education in this 21st century. Emphasizing and continuing with the current emphasis of conventional education is completely wrong. Fortunately for skills, something is happening, but traditionally skill training is considered separate from conventional education. In fact, we have been trying to map, you know, the skills and the skill levels achieved and ability to move people from the skill levels to the conventional education, conventional level to skill education, etc. But I think both have to go hand in hand. And the conventional education itself must emphatically incorporate skill education to the extent it's possible, at least to give an input to the students that it is the on-hand skills which will be essential somewhere or other. So I would say the focus of employment, but what I call sustainable livelihood, which could also mean an entrepreneurship, which could also mean working individually as a mechanic or as a supplier of, let's say, solar panels on top of your roof, whatever. Now, in my opinion, this requires a significant overhaul of the present education system. First and foremost, the education must teach people how to constantly learn, both during the education process and on the job. Sadly, we do not teach them how to learn. This is where I would like to significantly distinguish between the IIT system, the NIT system, and some of the top institutions that I have seen, where the emphasis is on thinking and learning how to learn as much as is on learning the proper subjects. Probably something from this system, the ethos of that system, can be brought in into the conventional education as well. Having said all of this, I am still not convinced that sustainable livelihood, which I mentioned, should be the key focus of the education rather than just a simple focus. The term key focus tends to be exclusive, which means that livelihood or employment has to be key focus, means nothing else is important or certainly not as important as that. I think, as has been amply stated earlier in the discussion on the liberal arts panel, this will preclude the important emphasis on holistic education, learning of languages, appreciating well-expressed thoughts, learning a broader perspective of life through knowledge of history and geography, appreciating and enjoying poems, nurturing and internalizing social discipline, which sadly is not taught. The number of people who cross red light in India are probably the largest as a percentage of the society anywhere in the world. Since there are no marks in the school education for training and testing whether people follow social discipline of traffic or not, people don't learn it. And finally, education to become a responsible citizen. I believe these are all equally important, if not more important, objectives of a good education. And this part should be the key focus. I'll end by saying that the problem of scale in this country is so daunting, we keep repeatedly stating that only 25% of engineering graduates are employable. I sometimes laugh at this. I passed my engineering at a time when the whole country used to produce about 10,000 engineers or 15,000 engineers in a year. And even then, I remember in 1966-67, there was a whole lot of unemployment situation in the country. A large number of engineering graduates I know joined armed forces because they were not getting jobs elsewhere. So employability and unemployability as a percentage will depend on two things. One is the number of employment opportunities available, and of course the basic training there. I would only like to say that incidentally the numbers are not correct. It is not 400,000 or 500,000. It is close to 1 million engineers who are passing out every year now. 1.25 million students join engineering every year now. That number has plateaued, although the number of engineering colleges are growing. But even if 25% of this number is employable, it means 250,000 engineers are found employable by the current employment. The country never produced even one-tenth of these numbers quite some time. I'm not suggesting that everything is hunky-dory. Of course, the percentage of employable people should be close to 100%. And there is a lacuna in our education. But I'm only trying to suggest that things are not as bad as they look. They're bad primarily because the employment opportunities are not getting generated to the extent and level that we need. And the employment opportunities would only be able to answer the supply and demand question. I'll conclude by saying that use of technology in both education and skill training has to be very, very seriously looked at. I was listening to the previous panel. I was sharing with Geeta that we train 10,000 teachers at a time. So a very important mission project, the MHR. Training 10,000 teachers at a time for a two-week intensive program at a cost which is roughly one-third the cost that is approved budget for a two-week training program per participant by AICTE has been made possible because of use of technology. We have just launched a T10KT or Train 10,000 Teacher program using MOOCs for which we have built a platform. We believe that a very judicious combination of a large activity online and some activity face-to-face could permit us to give quality training to everyone, teachers, students, and even to the skilled people. We'll be experimenting with a skill-based course soon on the MOOCs platform that we have created at IIT Bombay. We're doing this jointly with Tata Institute of Social Sciences. This is a skill program on creating educational animations using open source software. We will be able to report our findings only after 6 months or 8 months, but I'm convinced that the thinking everywhere is right. I think the problems have been identified. And the solution demands that we do not simply do more of what we have been doing, because that will not be very useful, but we judiciously try to use technology effectively with this. In using technology, an important aspect is the availability of the infrastructure, and the problem becomes daunting when you go to school. I was leading the Akash project. We did that project successfully. We actually distributed 1 lakh tablets to engineering college students, and we got a lot of applications and contents developed which are in open source, which run on any Android tablet. But our dream was that low cost, I mean, the name Akash is not important, probably because it came from the earlier regime. But affordable device must be available to every person in the country who wishes to learn. And that affordable device with free content accessible from that device should actually make a lot of changes in the whole scenario. It would be a game changer provided it is dovetailed properly into other aspects of changes that we are trying to deal with in the education system. So I am more hopeful than I ever was, because there is an opportunity, there is a challenge, and I think we can together answer both of these. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Professor Phatak. Next, Mr. Krishnakumar.
Good afternoon. When I got this invite from Indian Express, I was not too certain what my role in this is going to be, because clearly with a safe harbor statement, I'm neither a thought leader in the space of education, nor do I get actively engaged in that. So let me really take a view of being a rank outsider and really sharing with you my perspectives of what I think is really the role of education. Obviously, I think employability is the fundamental issue. Dr. Palamraju talked in terms of how skills need to be improved, which in turn will create more sustainable sort of employment. But in my mind, if I were to really break it up into two parts in which I'll share my perspective, one is really, what is the basic purpose of education itself? While employability is important, what is really the basic purpose? I really see three key aspects. One, the purpose of education is to build character. The second key element is, does education increase the curiosity quotient? Does it increase learnability in the people going through any part of education, formal, informal? The third element is, how does education really help people collaborate, work in teams, and really deliver outcomes? Maybe I think character may mean different things to different people. Let me just share one or two sort of insights in terms of what I think character is. One is clearly sensitivity to the world around you. Many times I wonder, if you go to a small nation like Sri Lanka, it's so spick and span. Because I think people are taught to be sensitive to the environment. They don't litter around. It's not, in a way, regulated environment like Singapore, where it's also spick and span. So how do you really inculcate sensitivity to the environment? Sensitivity to diversity. In fact, I come from the so-called knowledge industry, which is the IT industry. Many times I'm aghast at some of my colleagues who are so insensitive to their women colleagues. There's an elevator, everybody needs to go to work. Even when some women colleagues are just waiting, these are these guys rushing ahead and probably just trying to get the space, which I think is a part of being sensitivity to diversity, or for that matter, I keep repeating within many of our male colleagues in terms of sensitivity, when one of our project managers said that to drive a project on time, I really want to de-roster one of the women colleagues who's pregnant because productivity will not be high. So I think these are various examples, but I think education needs to build character and build sensitivity to diversity. So with that, let me sort of move on to something which I think I've seen from a far more closer perspective, which is really the engineering education part of it. Dr. Subramaniam rightly said that the McKinsey report, NASSCOM McKinsey report, has been quoted. Incidentally, I happen to be a part of that NASSCOM McKinsey report, so I'm not going to defend that, but clearly, when we think in terms of engineering education, and obviously the IT industry can talk about creating almost close to 3 million direct jobs and 9 million indirect jobs, but clearly, the focus should be on building the engineer of tomorrow. When we really say building the engineer of tomorrow, I think it's not just information technology and what work which you do for global clients. But I think the opportunity to create a difference in India is so much there in every sector. In the infrastructure sector, in the oil and gas sector, in every sector there's an opportunity to create a difference by building something which the engineer of the future will really be able to do. And what are the essential characteristics of the engineer of tomorrow, which I see as being important? One, I think problem solving. I think by nature, the practice of engineering needs to tackle problems and problem solving. Two, the mindset to really sort of bring in the right elements when you really solve the problem. The third is really, it is a science where you need to understand deeply the engineering knowledge which is important. Which probably again from an educational system it needs to change, that people need to learn concepts, not necessarily clear examinations and certification. So how do you get deep skills? And the fourth element, which I think is very important, is the real skills which are required to drive outcomes, which is the ability to work in teams, communication, the ability to collaborate. I do think, irrespective of what the NASSCOM McKinsey report has said, as long as we focus on building these capabilities and really creating the right skills for the engineer of the future, employability will really happen, because I think employability is really the outcome of people really building up capabilities for being the future engineers. Inherently, I think I see a lot of engineering institutions here. I think they are partly responsible for, I think, not focusing on these four key elements, because these are, I think, very simple. I don't think this is a magic science behind it. I think many of the educational institutions focus on the whole term of saying that how much people got placed, not just placed, how many people got placed on day zero or day one of when the campus recruitment started. To me, I think that's fundamentally the wrong metrics to measure. Because many times when educational institutions approach us at MindTree to say we got 100% of our people placed on day zero, I think that's completely a wrong metric. We'd like to see how good engineers you've really got out, rather than saying we placed 100% of our people on day zero. And how can this happen? I think clearly this has to happen. I think we've talked for a long about the lack of collaboration between industry and academia. I think clearly enterprises like us and the others need to start engaging far more with the academia, more in terms of generating very relevant student internships. How do we really exchange faculty to really keep faculty updated? Because at the end of the day, I think if you talk of it as a very discrete problem on how you're going to change the skills of faculty, I think it's not going to work. I think there needs to be a far more collaborative environment where faculty come in, work with the enterprises, really understand what the industry needs and really go back. So I think both academic institutions and enterprises need to take a position on this. Clearly, the learning methods need to be very different. I think we have not adequately focused in terms of research on pedagogy. How do we really drive new learning methods, while technology as a solution to everything is being talked about? It cannot be a panacea. I think it needs to be relevant technology with the proper pedagogy methods which need to be done. And more than anything else, I think research labs and interdisciplinary studies between academic institutions and enterprises, I think clearly will drive the whole notion of creating the engineer of tomorrow. And again, I'll really end with sharing our own example, because many times I think enterprises like us, which are in the business for making or creating value for our stakeholders, we tend to blame the whole environment, saying the government is not doing something, the academic institutions are not doing something. And certainly, I think many of us don't even provide and take adequate sort of ownership in terms of generating the outcomes in a very critical activity like what Ms. Raju said of the National Skills Development Corporation. And one of the most active sector skills council is the IT Skills Council. The fact is, what we did was clearly, I think, one of our single largest investments in the last 3-4 years as a company is sort of investing close to about 130 crores in what we call a global learning and development center, where we're really saying, if yes, there are issues around the environment, how is it that we can really start playing a role in terms of addressing some of this, which could be in terms of creating the next generation pedagogy for the future engineers, getting into a lot more collaborative efforts with the academic media, and really saying, in our own world, how can we really solve it? So I believe this also has to come by people committing, saying that yes, we can solve the problem, and really acting, saying that yes, we can do this by creating the right role modelship and a stewardship, not necessarily just talking about problems. I think it's time to move and solve problems and really share those stories and examples, so that together, I think we can really make things happen. Thanks so much.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. KK. That was actually not an rank outsider's perspective, I should say. He was very much a part of our community. Well, next, Professor Lalitha Balakrishnan.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. First of all, I'd like to thank Mr. Prabhu Chawla and the organizers for inviting me to be part of this elite panel. I'd also like to congratulate them. A lot was said in the morning about demographic dividend. But I would like to say that Mr. Prabhu Chawla and the organizers have invested a huge sum in this intellectual capital in this conclave by roping in so many star speakers, and I'm also referring to the enlightened audience who are sitting here, and you sum it all up and you get so much of intellectual capital, so the dividends you reap are going to be rich. So I should definitely congratulate the organizers on this. Moving on to the topic, should employment be the key focus of education? Education, right from school, we've been told, is nothing but the three R's: reading, writing, arithmetic. Taught very early, and definitely they help any person to have a career, take charge of numbers as he goes on, and live independently in adulthood. Education, we've also been told, is the key to shaping young people's attitudes, skills, and culture. It is the basic requirement for anything in life, not just employment. Putting it differently, it provides the basis for a career, not just a job. Having said that, education is definitely a good indicator for employment, since you have no major quantifiable yardstick to measure employability of a person other than education. Producing employable graduates is an important responsibility of educators, but definitely it is not their sole responsibility, neither is it their main responsibility. I would say education is giving the right transversal skills and competencies to be able to adapt to the ever-changing demands of the 21st century living, including but not exclusively the demands of the labor market. Universities and colleges are great centers of learning. They have always been places where the skills and knowledge of students are chiseled to suit the requirements of the workplace, amongst other things. Therefore, employment is an important area, but definitely not the only focus area of education. Then, what are the other thrust areas that we need to look at? Education is all about grooming an individual. When a small child comes up to you and is very polite in expressing what he or she wants, you feel delighted to have a conversation with that child. That is the essence of grooming that goes into an individual. Soft skills are vital for an individual to be an integral part of society. Education should provide these key skills and all of these competencies so that they go on learning for the whole of their lives. There is no stopping where learning is concerned. Learning is continuous and it affects all aspects of a person's life, whether a member of the family, a member of society, or a member at the workplace. Continuous learning or lifelong learning is therefore very important. Today in the information age, students also need to think deeply about issues, solve problems creatively, work in teams, communicate clearly in many forms of media, learn ever-changing technologies, and deal with a flood of information. The rapid changes in our world require students to be flexible, to take initiative and lead when necessary, to produce something new and useful. Therefore, a new bundle of skill sets and new competencies are to be given to them. In a world where change is continuous, it is not possible for education and training providers or even enterprises to predict accurately what the specific competencies will be required in the future. We should therefore facilitate the development of a culture that creates the best possible teaching and learning climate that fosters a culture of openness and continuous learning for all. Thrust and focus of education should therefore definitely be on stimulating the intellect, enabling creative thinking and problem solving. Here I'd like to recollect one of the poems I enjoyed reading as a child, The Charge of the Light Brigade by Lord Tennyson. Lord Tennyson wrote, "Theirs not to reason why, theirs but to do and die." That may have been written in a totally different context, but the words, "theirs not to reason why," people in those times did what they were told just because they were told to do it. But today, we are in a totally different generation. To be successful in life, one needs to ask essential questions. Essential questions when reading, writing, speaking, shopping, working, parenting, when forming friendships, choosing life partners, and interacting with mass media and the internet. Yet, few people are masters of the art of asking essential questions. Education should be such that it makes you curious to know the how and why of things, and there should develop a thirst for knowledge. This curiosity, wanting to know and discover, learn and innovate, leads us to another important thrust area in education, that is, fostering the spirit of entrepreneurship. Entrepreneurship is about those people who have inquisitiveness to think in new ways, the courage to meet and adapt to the challenges facing them. We require the right ecosystem where a great number of young people will emerge as thinkers and doers and successfully develop their own commercial or social ventures to becoming innovators. Entrepreneurial education should focus on a portfolio approach to maximize benefits, embedding three interlocking types of skills into entrepreneurial learning, namely personal awareness skills, business know-how skills, and social skills. Education should imbibe in its students humanism, tolerance, progressive thinking, and the search for truth. Institutes of higher learning should develop human capital, a class of people who do not indulge in cheating, plagiarism, and other fraudulent practices in academic activities. This brings us to the importance of value education, a subject very close to my heart. Value education is a crucial missing link in this education system, due to which the whole society is getting into chaos at personal as well as professional levels. Universities and colleges and all institutes of higher learning should therefore play a vital role in reviving the system by adopting all possible measures, institutional, curriculum, policy initiatives, etc. If value education is taught as a special subject, students may show callous and casual attitude towards the subject. They may not pay any heed to it. So, instead of putting value education as a special subject, the value component should be inserted subtly in the course content itself, in such a way that the students internalize the values along with the subject. Educational administrators can nurture the culture by strictly following dimensions like increased access, equity, quality, democracy and autonomy, participatory approach, encouraging practices in examinations by following continuous and transparent internal assessment, increasing team projects for developing the team spirit and tolerance, etc. Education should therefore equip one to perform well, and it shall also equip one to contribute to nation building. It must make you think of how to work selflessly for the country. Any foreign country you visit, you would find that the students or the children of that nation are taking pride in their leaders. And in India, when we have such a rich and varied heritage, such a long history, we should definitely take pride in our leaders. Education must make us think of how to work selflessly for this country. How to strengthen the great traditions and values of Indian society. How to serve the underprivileged sections of the society. How to care for the environment. Students' contributions to these causes will result in building an equitable and inclusive society. A real and genuine collaboration between government, industry and educators that aligns education and career pathways and develops an educational policy that works with the economic policy is the need of the hour. Thus, education is not for employment alone. It is for providing lifelong learning by equipping with the right skill sets, fostering a spirit of entrepreneurship, and most important, instilling in every individual the right values. Thank you very much for the patient listening.
Thank you, Professor Lalitha. Next, the last speaker, Professor Uday Desai.
So let me again start by thanking Mr. Chawla, the New Indian Express, for organizing ThinkEDU and giving me an opportunity to share my thoughts. I stick fundamentally to the employment aspect, which is the theme of this panel. And of course, being the last speaker, a lot of my thoughts are going to resonate with my earlier panelists. Okay. So what I would say is that education, as was pointed out earlier, has to be holistic. Yes, employment has to be one of the factors in it, and I'll come to it in a minute. Okay. But it cannot be the sole focus of education. If you're talking about skill sets, yes, employment has to be the sole focus, because skill sets are exclusively given so that the person will get a job tomorrow. What we should be cognizant as educators is that we are developing young minds, and fundamentally what we are developing are productive citizens. This is, as I would say, you know, a very, very important aspect, in the sense that we are not simply imparting skills, we are not simply imparting facts. Okay, when I am teaching technology, I am not simply teaching a programming language, but there are other aspects which implicitly get taught, and that is important. Another aspect, I'll just rephrase Alvin Toffler, and resonates with some of my colleagues who said, he has a very nice statement saying that today's job is to teach how to learn, unlearn and relearn. And this is something we have to keep doing all across our life. Most of us, if we look at our career path, this is what we have been doing. Very rarely somebody has stuck to that part where we learnt in college and then we followed the same career path. It's most unlikely. We have unlearned that. Yes, certain vestige of that will always be with us, but we relearn new things and we adapt and do new things as we go along. If employment becomes the key focus of education, we don't develop the ability to learn, unlearn and relearn, then what will the person do after a few years? In fact, recently I was talking to some of my friends in IT industry. When IT industry was really booming in the early days, okay, what they did was they hired a lot of people, okay, very good, everybody had employment, they did good work. Now these people have reached middle level management, but they don't have the skill sets of middle level management. So essentially IT industry is going through a crisis of middle level, that is, there are people out there who were actually hired as coders, but now they have to do management just because of sheer years that they have spent, and how are they going to handle it? Because we have people from IT industry here, they can talk more about it. So if we have an education system which focuses only on employment, soon we are going to run into this particular problem, that after some years, their education, that was the employment oriented education, will become redundant, particularly in today's time when technology is changing very, very rapidly. So this is something we should keep in. Let me give a couple of other examples, and it's very difficult to say what is it that will fetch employment. And I'll take maybe about 30 seconds to give two, three examples. One is my own student. This is IIT student, by the way, a very top-notch student, electrical engineering, Abhishek Jain. I still remember his name. So one day in fourth year, towards around April or something, he comes running to me and says, "Sir, I got a job with McKinsey." I said, "Great, congratulations." Then he says, "I'd like to thank you. Why?" He says, "I got a job. Why? Because in the lab that you taught me, you didn't ask me to write the typical experiment, but you said write a business plan. Because I did, this is many years ago, before entrepreneurship became a buzzword in India." Okay. He said, "Because of that business plan, McKinsey hired me." So he had spent 4 years at IIT Bombay, learned electromagnetics, electrical engineering, circuit theory, VLSI, God knows what not. Okay. Finally, that one document, which probably constituted perhaps 2% of his overall time, got him the job with McKinsey. Obviously, his education will come in useful, because he's not going to be doing the same thing with McKinsey forever and ever. Another example, these are two examples related to US. So when I was in US and teaching in US, I was a theoretical person, control theory, and I had a student, you know, he took a course in VLSI, totally outside the realm of control. Finally, he got a job with Intel. Why? Not that he had published papers in control, because he took that one course in VLSI. So it's very difficult to pinpoint. Today, it just so happens, a young faculty at IIT Hyderabad, GVV Sharma, emails me one interesting article. There is a gentleman by the name of Mike Rowe, okay, who is now with CNN. So when he was young, he was looking for an employment. So he goes to the interview, there was an interview going on, he said, "Okay, I'll also apply." And what does the interview panel ask him? They say, "Okay, young man, you have 8 minutes, without stuttering, without faltering, without making any mistakes, in 8 minutes, give me a lecture or tell me how to sell this pencil to us." Okay. This was the interview question. And actually, this guy did it. So in 8 minutes, he gave a strong pitch, without stuttering, without faltering, that you must buy this pencil from me. Literally a pencil, by the way. He got the job at the end of 8 minutes. Okay. So now when we talk about employment-based education, what is it that we are going to teach? It's very difficult to say what the employer is looking at. Many of us who have conducted interviews, we have already, all of us have done something similar. We ask that one thing to see, hey, does this guy have that one spark good enough for me. It's very difficult for me to judge what that spark that is required by that company. So therefore, holistic education is something which is very, very important. We have tried something at IIT Hyderabad. I was not going to speak on it, but my colleague Professor Phatak says, no, you should say. I think we can, what we have done is we have atomized the overall program where we have modules which are of 7 hours, 14 hours, you know, 21 hours, 28 hours, etc. in multiples of 7. My feeling is that if you have a 4-year program, we are looking at college education at the moment, some modules could be geared towards employment. So thereby, I am not saying you don't do anything. Don't completely ignore it. Yes, do incorporate, but in a modular fashion, and particularly if you are going to do employment-oriented education, what you should do is, a faculty member should not teach. I am the last person to teach employment-oriented education. I should get people from industry. Because they are the ones who will tell them, hey, this is what industry is looking for. And how do they come? Industry person is not going to come and teach a 42-hour course. But a 7-hour module, likely to do that. Thereby, A, we increase interaction between industry and institutes. B, our students get what the industry wants. And this has worked quite well. I'm not saying it's 100% success. We are also experimenting and innovating. But something which can actually create a lot of traction as we go along. A lot has been said about entrepreneurship. I'll just take about 60 seconds to elaborate on that. I think we all realize it. You know, just about 3-4 days back, we had a delegation from Estonia, University of Tartu. You know, what is Estonia? Anybody can guess what is Estonia well known for? We all use it. Skype. Skype came from Estonia. Okay, there is hardly anybody in this audience perhaps who have not heard of or not used Skype. Okay. Two kids in Estonia developed Skype, which eventually was sold to Microsoft for I think about $8 or $9 billion, somewhere in that particular range. You know, and what's the population of Estonia? I asked them that time, because I was also not fully aware. They said it is 13 lakhs. So I was joking. I said that is population is less than the population of Rangareddy district in Hyderabad area. Okay. So a small, tiny country, and there are interesting things. Practically every student has a company. It is amazing, you know, he said that University of Tartu, every student has a company out there. And to start a company, we have been talking about ease of starting business. He said, it takes 15 minutes for me to start. I go to the web, fill out a form, I get it, and immediately I get a reply, just like buying an air ticket. Okay, you get the e-form, e-certificate, and you start your company. And casually, one of the professors says, yeah, I have two students who have a company. They have about $1 million worth of seed funding, but they're looking for more. We are struggling to get maybe 20 lakhs of seed funding for incubator companies which are started at IIT Bombay or any of the IITs, even IIT Hyderabad, and very casually he says $1 million. So somehow there is this culture. Another interesting thing to create that, they have something called e-residency. You and I can become e-resident of Estonia, start a business in Estonia sitting in Chennai or Hyderabad. Now, I mean, this is an amazing thing. We always look at Silicon Valley, okay, when we talk about entrepreneurship. But occasionally, maybe we should look at these tiny countries because, see, being tiny, they are very agile and they can innovate. Innovate much faster and try some new things. And I think this is something we have to look at. I was terribly impressed and I told my faculty also that, hey, we should look at Estonia to see how we can really create an entrepreneurship ecosystem out here. So let me end with this particular proverb. I don't know who wrote it. I just found it on the web. Do not confine your children to your own learning, for they were born in another time. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Professor Uday. That was really, you parted off with some interesting information, especially how to become an e-citizen of Estonia. Anyway, this session we have adequate time for Q&A, and I would encourage as many members from the audience to please ask your question. Please raise your hand. Yeah, the first gentleman there, and then we'll take the second question from this side. There will be a question, and please name the individual to whom you're addressing the question.
I'm Professor Edwin from Austria, living in Oroville.
Can I have the microphone? Because I think this event is recorded. That way it will be easy for...
Good afternoon. Lovely people out there. Lovely people in here. I'm Professor Edwin from Austria, living in Oroville for 6 months, 2 months in Europe, and 4 months I go to 12 Asian countries giving talks and education, Chinese culture and so on. The question was asked, what is education? In Mali, Africa, education means to set an example. Isn't it beautiful? In Arabic, it means tanwir, light, something with beauty. In ancient Egypt, they lived in Egypt for 7 years. In ancient Egypt, education means to go through the door towards heaven. Question to you, why is there no word in Sanskrit for to teach? They say, instead of to teach, to help someone to rise in consciousness. Socrates from the West, the greatest person in the West, and Confucius, Kongzi from China, they did not say, I'm a teacher, I'm a midwife. I help the divine child to come forward. Beautiful? And to finish, in Japanese, there's a beautiful word called asobu. When I ask Japanese people, they know it means to play, but it means to study under a teacher. To play, studying under a teacher, it means flower arrangement. And then you can say, I've heard your uncle has died. I've heard your uncle has played chess. So easy life, playing and so on. Thank you very much.
Thank you, thank you. Can I have a question?
I am Muthi, a small unit founder and director that's called Map and Training Institute. It's a skill development institute. I was in the Indian Air Force for 23 years. After that, I joined as an MNC. I worked as a manager, the maintenance manager. I felt I should do something for the nation. So I started my career development for the children. I go to the rural colleges. I go to the rural schools. I ask the people, what do you want? Do after the studies. Sir, I want to become I want to become employable. When I ask the people, can you speak little word of English? So they say, sorry, sir, I can't speak English confidently. What we do for this, see, one side is that abundance resources available.
Can you come to the question, please, so that we...
See, the thing is, one side, abundant job opportunities available. Other side, my people are getting qualified, but they are not unfit to be employable. Reason is why? What they are going to do for this? Rectifying the system. The second question is, one side we said the security of the teachers, people get the job of teaching job. But like the case of private institutions, neither they have the security nor they have the confirmation of the job. But what moral they have to teach the children good moral or good ethics?
Okay, your first question is addressed to whom?
First question is addressed to anyone who can give the better answer for this. Second question,
the employment opportunity versus competency mismatch.
Yes.
Competency mismatch has not originated today. The competency mismatch will continue to prevail because an educational system has an inertia, even though it interacts with industry, redefines its syllabus, etc., etc. By the time that modified syllabus and the modified training takes effect, the requirements change. So it's almost a perpetual goal. That's the reason why I emphasize that education must inculcate training to learn. Coming back to this, the skill mismatch is not an order of magnitude. There are some basic skills, but the kind of skills which are required today are not available. I do believe that on one side, you must try to modify the skill training institution itself. On the second side, you must think of, you meaning all of us must think of providing supplementary training which will upgrade the skills. That's where I said that use of IT for massive courses with an appropriate pedagogy, very important, because we have been experimenting with the appropriate pedagogy also. It is possible to address this issue, but the problem is not whether the issue is addressable. Problem is there is no mechanism to address this issue. Institutions which are responsible for conducting skill training work in isolation, supervised and organized by a separate group which is impervious to these changing needs. Industry or the employers whose needs are changing do not find their voice reflected into this training program. So what we, in engineering, we call it perpetual meeting of minds between the employers and the academicians. Again, it happens with all well-known engineering institutions, but does not happen with all. It is far more important that this thing happens at the skill training institutions and the skill requirement employable jobs. That would be the only answer.
I just like to add one thing out here. You know, see, when we talk about this particular panel, I think that is half the story. The other half of the story is we have to create jobs also. This is today, that's not the topic of discussion, because just giving skills, training them is not going to be enough. Okay. Simultaneously, we need to create jobs. I think that's another thing, maybe the CII, then FICCI, SOCHAM, I'm sure I know some people out there, they're all working on that, they're all discussing that as to how to create jobs. Okay. And partly, I would say, the entrepreneurship that we talked about. So that has to be kept in mind, that we may impart skills, and it is still likely that the person won't find a job because we have not created enough of them.
I would just like to add one point. What you say is important, but this perpetual gap between the changing requirements of skills and the existing skills is certainly very, very critical. It's not only happening here. In the United States, it is predicted that in about 6 years' time, there would be about 1 million jobs for which there will be no appropriate skilled people available. So there are educated people, I'm talking about a developed society, but there would be a tremendous gap between the kind of skills that the education is giving and the skills which are required. So this gap filling is an important exercise, and you are very right, we must try to address this or start addressing it right from now. Very essential. So for example, take construction workers or take healthcare workers. The kind of training that is given traditionally and the kind of training that is required today in the field is significantly different.
And on your second question of job security, you see, no job is a secure job. In fact, the 6 pay commission salary for teaching faculty is equally comparable amongst comparable institutions. In fact, I have many a times risked my reputation to also offer another suggestion that, you know, PhDs today should come with an expiry date so that there is always performance for faculty members. And faculty needs to be measured. No job is a secure job, by the way. Yeah, I will take a question from a student at the back there. I will take a student's question and then...
Hi, sir. Good evening. I am Naveen Kumar from B.S. Abdul Rahman. My question is very simple. If employment is a goal of the education system, how can students be motivated for entrepreneurship?
So to whom do you want to ask this question?
To you, sir.
To me?
Yeah.
Okay. First of all, the panel, we have not decisively concluded that employment is the goal for education. If you have observed the way in which every panelist has presented their views, that employment is just one byproduct of the process of education, in which there is also an equally important requirement that students must also be exposed to various skills that are required to start on their own. Professor Lalitha Balakrishnan clearly mentioned the personal awareness skills, the business skills, how to start businesses. So that also must be an integrated part of the educational engagement that the student has. I will stop here. If others...
I'll tell you the problem of entrepreneurship by telling you a small story that happened when I was setting up the IT business incubator in IIT. 98-99 was a high time of internet, so a lot of proposals were coming. And one of the proposals, we had modeled our incubator on the lines of some American incubators which would charge a monthly fees. And our charges were 50,000 rupees a month, amounting to about 6 lakh rupees a year. We believe 2 or 3 students should be able to collect 2 lakh rupees each and create this. One company said, my father wants to meet you. And the father came and asked me, sir, what if they fail? I said, they're all IIT students. They will get good jobs later. So he still asked me, but I have a problem. My son will have a 2 lakh rupees loan on his head. Suppose he fails after a year and he may get a job, but he has 2 lakh rupees loan on his head. Who will marry him? I realized then that the ability of the typical Indian middle classes to take risk is abysmally low. I called Nandan Nilekani and Kanwal Rekhi and told them that I have a marriage problem. And I redefined the incubator terms to say that for 1 year we will not charge them a single paisa. We still follow that. For first year, the incubator does not charge any money. The point is, training for employment and training for incubation are not mutually exclusive. Training for employment is as much essential to understand. It's a precursor. You cannot become an entrepreneur unless you are trained to handle jobs. So both are not mutually exclusive. I am only suggesting that training for entrepreneurship spirit is what should be incorporated in every scheme of education. There should be additional electives and some special programs for those people who are more risk-taking ability, they can demonstrate, they could take up those additional programs. But the point is, today if we don't talk about entrepreneurship at all, there is no chance that in a conventional education system, entrepreneurship will suddenly fall from sky. That's the only point.
In fact, the lack of appetite explains the widening gap between illiterate employers and literate employees. Mr. KK also wanted to add.
I think Dr. Phatak rightly said that there is a certain set of skills or capability which entrepreneurship brings in. One could be in terms of solving real problems. The ability to really create a market and not giving up, which is really the self-confidence, and more than anything else, creating job. But what I think is also to be avoided is, because in a way, in today's context, I think both the media as well as external world is to be not exactly blamed, but I'm saying they create entrepreneurs to be heroes. Everybody thinks entrepreneurship is a slot machine. I'm here to make some quick money. Let me tell you, I think that's the worst reason why you should become an entrepreneur, because wealth beyond a certain point doesn't make sense. And why is it that we don't sort of idealize the social entrepreneurs who are creating equally a large or a higher impact than the entrepreneurs who are just wealth creators? So it has to be looked at that entrepreneurship is a skill which you pick up, which is in solving real problems and creating an opportunity for others to get employed. But if it's looked as a slot machine, then I think that's the worst thing to do.
That's well put. We'll take one last question.
Thank you, sir.
Okay, two questions.
Good afternoon, sir. Good afternoon, sir. My question is to Deepak Phatak sir or Uday Desai, sir.
Choose one, so that, you know, the other can be a little free. So choose one before you ask the question.
Uday Desai, sir. Sir, I work in TCS. I've been an engineer from electronics and communication. I've observed that nearly in each of the branches, in each branch of engineering, say electronics and communication or electrical or mechanical, only very few people pass gate examination, which is conducted by IITs, which says that this person is eligible for taking up a further degree. When you say that only 20,000 people are eligible for taking up a further degree, how come are the universities branding them as qualified engineers who can meet industrial standards? And isn't does this not call for a need for common and examination standards across all universities to decide the abilities of students? Thank you, sir.
No, your point is very well taken. In fact, there is a big review going on in AICT, and some of these questions are being heavily debated. So there is a strong feeling that there should be we have an entrance exam, there should be an exit exam. You know, and could be gate, could be something else. I really don't know. But yes, what you're saying is, you know, and that way at least it will benchmark that this is your level. I think your numbers for gate qualifications are perhaps not right. I think the numbers are much better than that. You know, because the reason I'm saying is today, if I'm not mistaken, this year was a little less, but about 13 lakh students appear for gate. And today, gate is used as a parameter by practically every public sector unit and large number of even private sector to gauge the quality of the candidate. Because it's very difficult for us to kind of, you know, for a company to judge the quality of a graduate, say, from southern India, from northern India, from different parts of the country. It becomes very difficult to calibrate them. So gate has become very popular. So this 30 lakh number is not that all 30 lakh want to go for postgraduate, not at all. Maybe what you're saying is right, 20,000 or maybe 1 lakh, you know, want to go for postgraduate, but the remaining 12 lakhs or more than that are appearing for gate as a benchmark that they can show that, look, I qualified, I got this mark, and I am good for you to hire me. I think this is a very nice syndrome. So what you are saying has happened naturally without us making any imposition, and perhaps these numbers will grow as we go along.
Yeah, Professor Phatak wanted to add.
The basic reason is that the conventional colleges and universities do not emphasize problem solving. If you see the percentage of people who pass from a gate exam from IITs and NITs and some of the better colleges is much higher, because the emphasis on problem solving. And this relates to the earlier argument where many teachers are not trained how to set question papers. Please note that for the last 50 years, the university exam system has not changed. Solve any 6 out of 10 questions. Question 1, describe this. Question 2, explain this. Question 3, write short notes on. Question 4, a small problem. The IIT system question papers are problem 1, problem 2, problem 3, problem 4, problem 5. End. Now that is the emphasis on problem solving, which is absolutely vital. But then, in the affiliated college system, what do you expect? Where the teacher has no responsibility and no accountability to the students. You know, there are exactly 4 countries, I am told, which have this affiliated college system. Rest everywhere, colleges are autonomous, which not only means authority but responsibility. Do you know which are the 4 countries? India, Pakistan, Bangladesh and Sri Lanka. The Great Britain, from which we borrowed these systems, became wiser decades ago and modified their system. We are still hung up with that.
Okay, let the last question have a one-word answer, please. So,
Oh, that will be okay. Good evening, sir. I'm Vivek. I finished my BTech from IIT Chennai. I'm preparing civil service exams now. Okay, so I'll put the question and then. We're talking about employment and skilling people, right? So our discussion at the end of the day points towards organized sector, which has right now only 5% of the jobs. Okay, unorganized sector has 85% of the jobs, and even within organized sector, 10% of the jobs are unorganized. So totally that comes about 95% of the jobs in India are like unorganized. Okay, so if we keep debating about organized sector, then we need to think of unorganized sector also, right? So, Pallam Raju sir is here, he was talking about...
Question.
So, at the end of the day, when we keep talking about skilling, and if there is huge unorganized sector, which will not have any productive growth in terms of employment, and then if that gets stagnated, if that doesn't turn down, so we can't think of growing at an accelerating rate of growth.
What's the question?
So that's the question. So if unorganized sector is stagnated at the higher rate as it is right now, so how do we go about that, and how can growth happen if that's the case?
So whom is the question? You want to take it?
Yeah, even Pallam Raju sir, if he can answer, or Shankar sir, anyone.
Okay, if you want an answer from Mr. Pallam Raju, you can have it offline. So
no, we can give him the mic.
So when I spoke about 90% of the, killing being in the unorganized sector, I did not mean that it is unproductive. It is definitely adding to our GDP. You know, if you look at our rural economy, once upon a time, agriculture contributed 60% of our economy. Now it's no longer that percentage. But productivity is happening, and the skills that are needed in the rural sector are continuing to create value. Now it's a question of, giving it a recognition in terms of a degree or a certificate. And that's what I said, that the current system allows us to recognize prior learning. And let's say if it's arts and crafts, the proof of the pudding is in the eating. And if our arts and crafts are getting picked up, and increasingly the demand is increasing, that means they're doing the right thing. But if that artisan chooses to get into the mainstream of education, wants to get proper learning, there is a methodology for that, where the National Vocational Qualification Framework kicks in. So what you should not misunderstand is that if it is in the unorganized sector, that does not mean it is not contributing to productivity.
So I just want to add one point. Kwadi is saying it's last. Here again, I think a lot many times we take this question of saying, what is the government doing, what others are doing? I think it's up to each and every one of us to take a problem and solve it. I'll just share in 30 seconds what at MindTree we've done. In a problem which is completely unconnected with us, this is the rag pickers in Bangalore. We have formed a cooperative of them, we have trained them, we have built a technology solution on how they'll do more productively. And just to give you an example, in 7 months, their earnings have gone up by 250%. because we have reduced middlemen, we have gotten nothing. Any of you want to get an idea of it, go to a site called igotgarbage.com. But I think it has to be individual ownership. Why are we expecting the government to solve every problem? I think it has to be individual ownership also.
Yeah, it's well said. So let me quickly summarize the major takeaways on the purpose of education, sustainable livelihood, that we should teach the consumer of education how to learn social discipline, building the engineers of tomorrow to collaborative teamwork, create new learning methods, entrepreneurship, nation building. Employment is just a byproduct of a possible peripheral competency that you have gained. So ladies and gentlemen, thank you very much for your patience, and I'm sure individually all of us have managed to collectively send a message that the purpose of education is not just to give you a certificate to exit the campus, but to enter a career for a sustainable livelihood. Thank you very much.
That was an extremely interesting session. Thank you, ladies and gentlemen. May I please invite on stage Mr. Chawla to kindly present mementos to our speakers.